Over the last 2 to 3 months, I've spent time studying the names of God as they appear in both Genesis and Exodus. Today, I'd like to attempt to speaking to my summation, and very incomplete as it is, to really begin a conversation on how we view God through the names that appear in both Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, the name of Elohim and the name of Yahweh. It's interesting that Elohim is only mentioned in the first chapter of Genesis, where in Genesis 2, we're introduced to Yahweh in conjunction with Elohim. I found that both names, they do speak to God's character. I found in my own life that I can pinpoint the name that resonated the most, that guided me the most for my long period and my long walk with God. I'm going to speak about that later. This study presents an overview of both names, specifically as they're defined in the first two chapters of Genesis and the first few chapters in Exodus too. My intent is to provide this summation in part one, then enter a conversation with good friend Steve Staten on the ramifications on both a personal and collective level on how we view God. Below here, you'll see that I list a number of references that have really guided my thinking. So in looking at these two names and how they speak to God's character and also how they speak to us and how we view him, I wanted to look and see how many experts in the past have seen a difference in the creation story found in Genesis 1 and in Genesis 2. And I've put here on the screen some of the transcript from both, some of the text from both of these. So it says in Genesis 1, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them." Sounds a little strange. This is as the Hebrew is written. "And God blessed them, and God said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the heaven, and over the beast, and all over the earth." And then in Genesis 2 we read, "And the eternal God formed the man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the eternal God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and the eternal God took the man and placed him in the garden of Eden to serve it and to keep it." All my time looking through Scripture, I always view Genesis 1 as kind of an overview of creation and Genesis 2 getting into the nitty-gritty of what actually happened. And there has some truth to that, obviously, but there's actually a lot of nuances that are different that I think as we get into this, you'll see. So let's look at the differences, the discrepancies between both of these versions. So in Genesis 1, man's created in the image of God, and you have to ask yourself, well, how? It doesn't go into detail there. In Genesis 2, it describes the how. Man is fashioned from dust of the ground, but also breath from God. And then looking at the second thing is that there's, in Genesis 1, there's kind of a utilitarian mandate from God that he's to fill the earth and to subdue it. In Genesis 2, you don't get that language. Man is charged with duty to cultivate the garden and to keep it. And in the Hebrew, really, it means to serve it. And so not that dominance theme that we saw in Genesis 1. Genesis 1, we see that male and female were created together. Whereas in Genesis 2, Adam came first, then Eve came secondly, as his helpmate and his complement. And then finally, as I mentioned, Elohim is the only word used for God in the creation story of Genesis 1, whereas in Genesis 2, there's a combination of Elohim and Yahweh together, so Yahweh comes on the scene. So what I want to do first is look at Elohim as it's described in Genesis 1, and really it goes, in effect, it dives in a little bit into Genesis 2, so it goes up to verse 3, but we're going to call that creation 1. And so some of the bullets that we mention here, and I think I go through this. No, we'll go back. And so some of these bullets we hit earlier, but these are a few extras. So in the beginning, God, you can see the word God is Elohim, created. And just for reference, Elohim is mentioned 33 times, Yahweh, none. You'll see in the Genesis 1 account that there's lots of separation, creating space for these different elements to come into being. So light and darkness are separated in verse 3, water from water in verse 7, water from dry land in verse 9, and day and night in verse 14. There is a linear movement towards creation from our perspective, where it goes through the 6 days. So reproduction is mentioned in kind. So you see this with vegetation, with fish and water life, wild animals and livestock and all creatures. Also, the aspect of being fruitful was not just a mandate for man, but it was a mandate for vegetation, for all life, sea life, birds, humans. And then finally, the description of the male-female relationship, really neutral terms used for them in the Hebrew, zakar, and I'm not even going to pronounce the female version, but they're also created together, and they have dominion over all things, and so there's not this separation of creation. And then in like manner, or in difference in manner, is Yahweh. And so if we look at the creation story number 2, Genesis 2, 4 through 25, I want to start in Genesis 2, 4. Very interesting verse. This is in the ASV. It says, "These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that Jehovah God," which is the Yahweh Elohim, "made earth and heaven." And so, little comparison, in Genesis 2:4, Yahweh is introduced, and it's always used in conjunction with Elohim. So Elohim, Yahweh is kind of the conjunction. It says the day that God made. The creation from God's perspective is really one day. It doesn't have that linear progression that we see in the first section of Genesis chapter 1, where it's 6 days. Reproduction is not mentioned as in kind. As an example, trees in Genesis 2:9 have a visual pleasing to the eye mention, and also for good for food. And so there are attributes that are put that are more in the sense of connection. The aspect of being fruitful is not in Genesis 2. The male, female, they're not mentioned the same way. They're mentioned as Ish as man and woman as Isha. They're created separately. The term, and getting back to the term Ish and Isha, the Hebrew language looks at that as very poetic and more connecting than the male, female. They're created separately. The whole issue of having dominion over all things is not present. It's not good. It says it is not good for man to be alone. And the word, the Hebrew word is, again, the pronunciation, hey, what? But it's an accent, basically looking at the aspect of being. When it says to be, it's you know, Adam is looking at, my being presence is affected by this aloneness. And then in Genesis, if you read down in Genesis 2:23, it says bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. And also that bone of my bones has a more connection, because the Hebrew also allows it to go to a frame of reference of essence of my essence. And that word is etzem. And it's basically means a coming together. So there's a kind of a tenor of separateness and separation that God in the creation story in Genesis 1. But in Genesis 2, there's a story and a narrative of coming together. And you see this especially with Adam and Eve. And then what I want to do now is just do a comparison of these between Elohim and Yahweh in these first two chapters. And so we've mentioned this. You've got in creation 1, separation, bringing together, and in creation 2, trees reducing kind, pleasing to the eye, male, female, fill the earth, and there's rule involved, and man and woman, Ish and Isha, essence, reconnection and being, and then rule and subdue the land in Genesis 1:28, and then serve the land. So the actually the phrase that's mentioned in Genesis 2:15, which is really interesting, let me just read it from the NIV here. It says, "The Lord took man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it." That term "to work it" comes from a different word, and it actually does mean to serve the land. So this whole dominion over is not present in the second rendition of creation. And so in bold, I show you here that the Elohim, if you were to kind of summarize just the aspects mentioned, there's rule, there's power, there's judgment, because you'll realize that after every time he says it is good, that's a judgment character. However, in the second phrase of Yahweh, there's more of reconnection and bringing together. There's more of an empathy and moving together in conversation. Very fascinating. So let's look at, kind of introduce the term Yahweh as it's found in Exodus chapter 3. And I'll start in verse 15 of chapter 3 as we run into the story of Moses and Pharaoh and these interactions. And we'll stay here in Exodus for a moment. So in verse 15, it says, "God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, which is Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation." And so this introduction of the name Yahweh, God says, this is who I am. And I want to be able to you to understand what this means. And he really goes into detail. If you look at verses 7 through 9, it forms a sort of chiasm, which you can see here. I'm going to read this, and you'll see the chiasm. And a chiasm simply is a way in which the ancients wrote to put the summation, the piece that you really wanted to focus in on at a certain place within this structure. And this is a chiasm where it really runs to the middle of the paragraph rather than the end. In our English language, when we write a narrative and a story, we tell the story, but then we get to the conclusion and everything is summarized in the conclusion. That's not really how it is within the writings of the Hebrews. And actually, this has helped me a lot in understanding that this is a extraterrestrial document when I see the way the writers wrote these things and have these chiastic structures, which are really fascinating. And that's a rabbit hole we can go down later, but not right now. So verse 7, it says, "The Lord said, I have indeed seen," and you see that in verse 7, "the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. And then finally, I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them." There's action. "Then from the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, a home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way of the Egyptians are oppressing them." And so you see this chiastic structure, and you see this is immediately following or immediately preceding what his name is. And so as you're seeing this conversation with Moses, with God, with Yahweh, and expressing, this is my heart, this is who I am, you see elements of empathy, you see elements of action. These things are kind of encapsulate this term of Yahweh. And when you go back to Genesis 2, you see that frame of reference as far as connection and empathy. There's so much that's involved in that term, in that name. And then Pharaoh, he gets introduced to this term, and we see in Exodus 5, we'll read this piece by piece. Okay, let's do that. So in Exodus 5, verse 1, it says, "Afterward, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Let my people go so that they may hold a festival to me in the wilderness." And again, in the English language, when we read our Bibles and we see the word Lord, that is basically the way that's describing the word Yahweh. And when it says God, that's usually the way it states Elohim. And so they don't express it in the Hebrew words, but we can get a gist of what's really happening there. And so you can see that as I've highlighted those two different words. So we see that Moses and Aaron go to Pharaoh and they express this term Yahweh. And you'll see that Pharaoh doesn't understand this term. And but let's look at the action. There's such a relational language here. Let my people go. It's his people. There's a connection, which is very foreign to Pharaoh and the ways that they interacted with the gods. They did not interact. There was a lot of fear there. And then it mentions, hold a festival to me in the wilderness. That's something that expresses a joy, a time of festivity, a type of joining together in community. So here we go. My people, festival, Yahweh, relational. And then look at Pharaoh. He says, who is this? Who is this Yahweh? And so he mentions Yahweh. He doesn't know this name, that I should obey him and let Israel go. I do not know Yahweh. I will not let Israel go. And then you'll see Moses, Aaron, they'll shift the conversation into a language that is understood, I think, by Pharaoh. So they start off with Elohim. They'll mention Yahweh later, but they get into it right away, and they describe a God that I think resonates with Pharaoh, and he understands. It says, the God of the Hebrews has met with us. Now let us take a three-day journey into the wilderness to offer sacrifices to the Lord Yahweh, our God, Elohim, or he may strike us with plagues or with a sword. And I think by now you can see that this is a little more harsh than the first statement. I mean, the term he has met with us has kind of a distance to it, and it actually has this meaning, he's happened on us. So it's not very connecting. It's not very relational. He says the God of the Hebrews, and if you look at the term, it doesn't say my God. It says just the word is just a power. It's spoken in third principles and third person. You know, Hebrews is a generic term that I found that really talks about a migratory people. So it's not, if you ever been introduced by a friend and they don't really dive into talking about who you are or spend time even recognizing or just allowing you to be in this conversation, you feel a little bit distant and hurt from that. Says he happened on us, very impersonal. Let us take, it's not commanded. He mentions offering sacrifices. There's really no mention of celebration. And there's fear, it's a fear-based world. And that's something that Pharaoh absolutely knew and understood. And so what I want to do now is transition into a discussion. That's going to be in part two, and you can click on the link here. But we're really gonna move into this place of conversation with my friend Steve. Looking at the comparison between these two stories, and looking also at the aspect of what man looks like, Adam, and we call him Adam 1 and Adam 2, and talking about what a resume person is versus a eulogy person is. We'll talk about that. And then secondly, how does the way we see God through these two names shape our walk with God? I've been changed by this. It's given me a perspective of how I've walked and what my future looks like in walking with him. And then finally, kind of a big picture, how have these two perspectives influenced the church, the evangelical church? And so we'll stop there.